Welcome back to the show. Thank you, everybody. We got a birthday in the house, right? We'll have to find out who you are and give you a shout out, okay? Thank you for coming. I appreciate that, really. Make some noise. Make some noise. And everybody, let's give it up for the After Hours Funk Quartet once again. Ronnie Fells on keyboards. Ronnie, how you doing?
Yes, sir. I'm doing pretty good.
You doing good?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, really? Is that how you talk all the time?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'll talk to you later. Anyway, our next guest is a lover of blues and jazz, and his passion comes out regularly on KCUR's The Fish Fry. And he's written a book about the history of jazz and blues in Kansas City. Let's welcome to the program Chuck Haddix.
Tana, you look lovely.
Thank you for having me.
Good to be here with you guys. Thanks for having me on.
All right.
What a good looking crowd out
there. It is.
It's
a very
good
looking.
They are very clean.
They are very clean.
They smell good too.
Yeah. Well, that's a plus. That's a bonus. Chuck, first of all, you've been on the radio now for going on over 20 years now.
Yeah, I've been on the radio since 1985. Originally, I started out as a jazz producer. And then about a year later, I started doing The Fish Fry, which is blues, soul, rhythm, and blues, jump, and jive.
I love that name, by the way. I love that name.
I wanted to stretch out a little bit. I found that jazz was too restrictive. I wanted to be able to play, you know, some wild stuff on the radio and just open the playlist up a little bit.
Now, I've got a question for you, because you know I was recently fired from the radio, so what's a really good song to listen to? What blues song? So you can really wallow in it. And I think a lot of people in that situation, people are losing their jobs, and you know, you gotta hear the blues.
Every day I have the blues. I mean,
would be a good one?
You may have a future in the blues, Tana. The nice thing about public broadcasting, as we see with Walt Bodine, you know, Bill Shapiro and me, is you have tenure. You're there a long time.
They can't fire you.
They don't fire you. No. Yeah, they usually don't. You usually don't get fired.
You should go put in an application.
Yeah. I've already done it.
No. Yeah, okay.
You definitely should. Definitely should.
Now let's talk about the book and the research that went into this and the passion. Obviously, this took a lot of research. This city is rich in history when it comes to jazz and blues. What gave you the idea to do it?
Well, there's never been a really good book written about Kansas City's music, blues and jazz. And I was actually, you know, I'm also the director of the Mars Sound Archive, so I collect collectors. I work in a room with 300,000 sound recordings. And also, you know, I collect photos and related manuscripts for the university. So Frank Driggs has the largest collection, my co-author has the largest collection of photos in the world. I mean, he has fabulous, you know, hundreds of pictures of Basie.
Wow.
And so I was in New York City for a conference, and I went by to hustle him on his photos to see if we couldn't get those to come to Kansas City. And he'd had a contract with Oxford to write a book about Kansas City jazz, but he really hadn't made much progress. And so he asked me to come aboard, and so they rewrote the contract, and I came aboard. And so what I did is I went down to the Kansas City Public Library, that's the old site on 12th Street, and went through all the microfilm of the Kansas City Call and made copies of all the music references. That told me when things happened. And that's an adventure in itself, because you know, you're sitting there at a microfilm reading machine, and it's a lot like playing a slot machine. You're, you know, putting dimes in, and you're sitting next to a street person with a real bad cough, you know. And, and then I organized it into a timeline, and then I collected all the interviews, and then I wove the two together into the narrative. And it took about 7 or 8 years to write the book.
By the way, for you people out there that live in Blue Springs, the Kansas City Call is the black newspaper in town, just so you know. If you ever play Trivial Pursuit, Kansas City South.
Yeah, well, when you're doing this, you run across some real interesting things, like Joe Turner's arrested for shooting a woman. Big Joe Turner.
And what's happening
it was
right
a married
now?
Woman, and they asked him why he did it. He said, well, she wouldn't leave me alone.
Good reason. Now, I've always heard that, I don't know if it's a rumor or not, but like a band would play at 18th and Vine, and then they leave, you know, go down the plaza for a half hour, come back, and that same song would still be playing.
Sure, yeah. The music happened all over town. You had these big venues like the Playmore Ballroom, the El Torreon Ballroom. Yeah. During the summer, you had Fairyland Park. And also, 12th Street was like Las Vegas is today. It stretched a mile east of downtown. And Dave Dexter estimated there was as many as 20 saloons in a single block.
Oh, yeah.
And you know, Kansas City was a wide open town. That's what really fostered the music. You know, on 14th Street, just in the shadow of City Hall, was a red light district. and women would literally sit in these windows and tap nickels on the windows when the Johns walked by.
You could get them for a nickel?
Yeah.
Whoa, inflation.
Yeah, inflation, yeah. That's a lot of money in those days. That's what we're talking about during the Depression.
Yeah.
And, you know,
you think they might bring that back?
I don't think so.
You campaign for it.
Just
well,
checking.
Well, there's good reason that we have gambling here, that we have, you know, major narcotics distribution center, and there's women in certain parts of town waiting, standing on the curb, not waiting for the bus. That's the way it's always been here. Kansas City was a very wild place back in the 20s and 30s. So what I did is, in the first chapter, I just painted this real lurid portrait of Kansas City. I mean, the clubs were really very colorful. They had this one club called on the State Line, and what they had actually had a line drawn down the middle of it, and when cops would raid from Kansas, everybody would step across the line to Missouri, and they couldn't run anything with them.
Well, back to the nickel on the window. Okay, so the girls had tapped a nickel, and the guys knew that that's what would cost
Tana,
them.
Tana, that's enough.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. Yeah.
Okay, I'm just. Right.
Oh, yeah. Well, get their John's attention. And the Edward Morrow described his cab, the sound of the nickels tapping on the window to his departure of his cab to hail. It's like a hailstorm.
Oh, yeah? So many.
Yeah, it was a very exotic place. Kansas City was, you know, bootlegging during Prohibition. It was business as usual.
Wow. You know. Well, Chuck, let's tell the people where they can find you on KCUR. You're on Fridays and Saturdays, right?
Friday and Saturday nights from 8 to midnight on FM 89.3, also KCUR.org. It's public radio party featuring the finest in blues, soul, rhythm and blues, jump and jive, and Zydeco.
All right. Well, what saloon can they find you at?
Not too many. Knuckleheads is where they'll find me at. Yeah.
Let's give it up for Chuck Hattis, everyone.
Thanks.
This is After Hours. We'll be right back.